Okay, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in Philippines. This is the third time I've restarted this video because I just can't stay on topic tonight because I just don't know where to go with the things that's going on. I just want to say this. No man knows the day or the hour of the rapture. Someone had messaged me and said that someone, I don't know who they were talking about. I don't have time to watch many videos. Maybe none. Every once in a while I watch a video someone asked me to. It's a brother or sister, that's their video I watch. Someone made a video saying the rapture would be on 3/22 this year, which it could be. It could be any day. And then the person asked me, they said, you know, I told them that we don't know the day or the hour. And then the person who made the video told them that, well, you're not even a Christian. If you don't know when the Lord's returning, you're not even a Christian. All Christians who are part of the bride will know the day the Lord's returning. Now, that's not true. You know, the Lord will, you know, it'll be announced, you know, the midnight cry already went out, I believe, in 2011. Multitudes of people were awakened in 2011. I was already studying the end times, but the urgency was quickened a hundredfold in 2011. And I was convinced that the rapture was going to be 2011. I think a lot of people were, too. I mean, I was just like every day I was surprised it hadn't happened yet. But I never set a date. But I was just believing it was that time because the Lord was sending an awakening. And then it says there in the parable of the 10 virgins I'm talking about from Matthew 25, it says, you know, why the five went out to buy oil, then, you know, the bridegroom showed up. So, you know, it's like if they had known when he was going to show up, they wouldn't have went to get oil. They would have already had their oil. But anyway, even the other ones didn't say to them, you know, they said, go, the five virgins who were there, okay, in the parable. And the Bible already tells us no man knows the day or the hour, but I'm giving you a little bit of wisdom here from, because a lot of people like to get really, you know, they like to get esoterical on you and all that and get out there. And instead of just taking the plain text that already tells you no man knows the day or the hour, they want to get deep. So let's go out there. Okay. Those five virgins, they didn't tell them, hey, you don't have enough time to buy oil. The bridegroom's going to be here in 5 minutes. They didn't say that. They said, no. We don't have enough oil to share with you. Go, therefore, to those who sell oil and buy you some and come back. They, you know, so they didn't know that the bridegroom was going to come while they were going to get oil, or else they probably would have shared with them, right? Or they would have said, hey, you don't have enough time. It's too late. You're out of luck. They didn't say that, right? So that's just a, you know, a little added on there, a little wisdom that, you know, shows you even from the deeper side of things, it's still not saying that anyone knew when the bridegroom would come, the exact moment. But we know that he's on the way. And that announcement's already went out. I believe the signs that the Lord gave us of his return and what's also written in the epistles, that's the midnight cry. It's already went out. Okay. Now, there's lots of things. What I want to talk to you about, I made some videos. If you go to my channel, and I can't remember everything that I said, but I made some videos about these are non-biblical sources that say that the Lord would return basically in 2012, okay? But I just want to talk about this. For one thing, the cycle for the 2012 cycle of the Mayans and all, these are non-biblical sources, okay? But the cycle for that is the precession of the equinox, okay? Or the Ouroboros, okay? And that's a cycle of like 25,000 and some odd years, okay? So one little tick of that is like, you know, 1 degree tick of that is like 72 years. So for a few months, okay, we're still in 25,000 some odd years. How much we've moved from the 2012 December 21st day is just, you know, just a click, a second of time when you're talking about that much time, 25,000 some odd years. So we're still kind of in a window for that, okay? Now, I know that's a non-biblical source, but there's tons of sources. That's what I want to talk to you about. Okay, everybody always rejects sources that are not from, say, a born-again Christian. As I've mentioned before, just in a video I think I made yesterday, God used, you know, Balaam, and God used a donkey. God used King Nebuchadnezzar, okay? And God used, and I made videos about this. I can't remember what all I said. But God just used lots of non-biblical sources to get, you know, his truth out. So the Saint Malachi prophecy, okay, was supposed to have been received in about 1100, basically. Okay, let's just say 1100. But it was hid in the Vatican and wasn't published till 1500 and something, okay? So people would try to say it was a forgery or whatever, but it's been publicly published since the 1500s, okay? So you still got 400 or 500 years of popes to look at, okay? And then the book, as an example, an exhaustive, you know, scholarly work, Petros Romanos, which I read. I got it when it first came out because the Lord led me to get it. And that Apollyon 12, the Apollyon Rising 2012, also by Dr. Tom Horn. All that stuff is proven accurate. It's very good information. He's in a, you know, retired Assemblies of God pastor before he started publishing books for 25 years. Okay. He doesn't claim to be a prophet, but he was led by the Lord into making these books and doing the research. His new one, Exo Vaticante, is coming out sometime by the end of this month. They're rushing it through. They've got a telescope they call Lucifer, and they're waiting for the aliens to land. And they believe that the aliens will have a better gospel. I mentioned this in videos before. This is what the Vatican astronomers are saying. And it's in his new book coming out. You know, they believe that, you know, maybe they never fell. They're saying that when the aliens landed, they have a better gospel because they never fell. Or they got a different gospel from God because they were on a different planet. Okay, and then we need to listen to them. So, you know, another gospel, think about it, you know. The fallen angels coming down and saying, we created you. You know, we built the pyramids. We built Stonehenge. We built all that. We're the Titans. You know, we're the Clash of the Titans. We're the, you know, all that. Poseidon and whatever, all those ancient Isis, Horus, whatever, all these ancient gods. You know, the all-seeing eye above the pyramid. That's us. We created you. We took the DNA of a monkey and mixed it like the Sumerian tablets and all that. That's a high possibility. Apollyon. Okay. So, that being said, and suppose that, you know, that it doesn't happen, it's also possible that a human will be possessed by Apollyon. The Bible says the beast that comes out of the bottomless pit, he's the leader over those who come out of the bottomless pit. His name is Apollyon. And then it says the beast that came out of the bottomless pit will kill the two witnesses. Okay, so the beast, the mark of the beast, is Apollyon. It's like an unholy trinity. Satan, it says, because I see all these comments that people write, they never even read the Bible. Okay, you need to read all the Bible, the whole book, before you're making all these comments. To understand the end times, you got to know the whole Bible. There's types and shadows to the whole thing. Okay, the whole Bible, you got to know it. You can't be a New Ager, somebody's not even a Christian. It's a New Ager who makes all these videos saying that the tribulation period has been shortened less than 7 years. Person's not even a Christian. Go look at their wall and see their videos. They're a New Ager. Okay, and they're just capitalizing on the on what the Christians are waiting on. Anyway, when you see that Apollyon, okay, is the name of the beast, okay, so will he possess a man like the President of the United States, or the Pope, or whoever, Prince William, or whoever people may think, or will he actually come back himself in the form of a man? Angels appeared as men in the Bible. You see the two angels at Sodom and Gomorrah, people thought they were men, okay, but they were not. They were angels. They were holy angels who came there to judge. And then they were trying to have relations with them. They wanted to rape those angels, the Sodomites. That's what was going on. And then they blinded them. That's read it there in Genesis, the story with Lot in Sodom, in the city of Sodom. So we don't know how this is all going to play out, but let's just suppose that it's going to be a man who's going to be possessed. And that's the theory that would run with what's going on in the month of March, because we don't know. And, that, you know, every time I make a video, someone will make a comment that, oh, I know it's the Pope. No, you don't know it's the Pope. You think it's the Pope, and there's a lot of evidence to support that it could be the Pope. But the Bible doesn't say it's going to be the Pope. And people say Antichrist means in place of Christ, not against Christ. Oh, well, it can mean either one, okay? It can mean either one. I just say this because I just laugh. I just imagine that if you saw, there's, you know, these legal videos on YouTube from a lawyer like the ACLU, like, you know, how to keep the police from searching your car and all this without a warrant and all that. I can imagine you going on there criticizing that lawyer on what he talks about, the Constitution and, you know, how they have to have a warrant to search your car. Go on there and straighten him out. You know, you read some law book or you saw some old videos on YouTube. You're going to straighten out that lawyer or that doctor. That's why I only laugh. Because people, you know, when I was in nursing, when I was a medic in the Army, okay, and I worked in a hospital and that was the best job I ever had, working in a hospital in dermatology. And you know, then they have the physician's assistants, you know, and I wanted to go to school to be a physician assistant at that time, but I didn't make the cutoff to get into the class because they only had 20 per year. And anyway, they try to make it really diverse. And so it's hard to get in. Anyway, the doctor would, you know, make a comment about PAs and say a little bit of knowledge is dangerous. And that's really true. A little bit of knowledge is dangerous. You know, there's lots of people like a paralegal or a paramedic, you know, because I was licensed as a paramedic before too. You know, I can imagine going in the hospital and telling the doctor what he's doing wrong and all that, you know. So we have to be humble, all of us. I'm not a doctor of theology. And then if someone's a doctor of theology, you can specialize in different stuff like eschatology is end time study, you know. And then so we have to have a good rudimental base and understanding of the Word of God before we start making comments, because the things that I see people say, I know right off the bat they don't know they've never read the Bible. They're coming from an angle that is not based on their own careful, diligent, humble study, but they're spouting something somebody else said. So that's why I would challenge you today: study for yourself, be open-minded, you know. But yet, you know, always look at things in the light of the Word of God. The Bible says to be slow to speak, you know, quick to listen. You know, so, but the problem is lots of people are so quick to speak and slow to listen. And that's the hindrance that we have in the body of Christ to getting down. You know, if we had everyone, you know, working as a unified brothers and sisters, we'd probably already know a whole lot more about what's going on than we do. It's the disunity people that are getting those who are hearing from the Lord all worked up and distracted from studying, because they're all upset because people are insulting them, attacking them, and all that. Now, that's what I see from those who are truly hearing from the Lord and true watchers. They spend a huge amount of time dealing with the wacky people. So I asked you, if you don't want to be, you know, categorized as a wacky person, if you don't want to be, you know, hindering the people of God who are, you know, making the videos, or, you know, there's some people who just troll. You know, they just like, they don't believe in the rapture. So they go on the internet, just every time they see the title of something, rapture, they go on there without even listening to the video and make a comment, you know, that the rapture is a false teaching. You're going to hell. Everybody's going to hell, believes in the rapture. It was made up by, you know, a handicapped girl 100 years ago, whatever they say, which is totally not true. But that kind of is an example, you know. And now I expect that from the atheists who go on there and say, you know, Jesus is not God. It's a made up. People that believe in God are weak, or what, you know, whatever it might be there saying. But for Christians to do that to other Christians, I would say that you can judge a tree by the fruit that they bear. So I would say, you know, maybe they should be worried about the fact, or I'm thinking, you know, maybe they might not be a Christian if they would do that, you know, because we can agree to disagree on these issues. Anyway, now that I did some preaching in there, March, brothers and sisters, it's just so much going on. There is, and I made videos about all this, but I want to catch up to speed. In the Kabbalah teaching, I know it's not biblical, okay, but it's mystical stuff, okay. And the Kabbalah and their book, what's the name of it? Anyway, it's not coming to the top of my head right now. Anyway, in the book of the Kabbalah, their main book, they say that the Messiah, okay, they rejected Jesus as the Messiah, okay. So if they say the Messiah is coming and he's not Jesus, then of course we're probably talking about the Antichrist. They had a vision of the Antichrist appearing in Rome in this Jewish year that began in September, whatever it is, 5773, whatever it is, from September of 2012 until then, you know, August 2013 is the window. And the prophecy is in that Petrus Romanus, but basically says that he will appear at Rome, and then Rome will be destroyed from fire from heaven, and then the Messiah would reveal himself, begin to reveal himself, and nations would rally to him and all this. Okay, that's this year. Now, that was written about 700 years ago, at the same time that Petrus Romanus' book, the Malachi Prophecy of the Popes, was unpublished and hidden in the Vatican and stowed away. So the, you know, about 200 years after Malachi, and his stuff was never made public, the Kabbalist Jewish mystics, they wrote their stuff, and in there they said, in the same, you know, in this time, it just happens to be at the time of the last pope, that there would be a gathering of kings in Rome, and then that's when there would be destroyed, Rome would be destroyed, and then the Messiah would begin to reveal himself at Rome. Okay, so that's all pretty wild. And then also, there was a Jesuit priest, okay, and his last name was Tebow, so it's easy to remember, right, for Americans now, a football player, Tebow. He was a Jesuit priest who was a Monsignor, and he died right after he published a book in 1951 that was only written in French about the mystery of the prophecy of the popes. Now, this guy, he studied the prophecy of the popes, you know, for its esoterical, supernatural ability to it. So he used like the Bible code like type deal on it. He used anagrams. He used all these different code techniques and even natural sources of counting the average reign of a pope from the time of the beginning of there was a pope, you know, officially a pope, whatever it was, say maybe about 300 or 400 AD until his lifetime in 1951. What was the average reign of a pope in years? And every calculation he did, about 10 or 20 different calculations, all came out to 2012 to 2013. Okay, and he also said, based on these anagrams, that the last pope would resign. You know, the second to the last pope would resign. And he said it would be March or April 2012. Okay, so that's why Dr. Tom Horn said in his book that he believed the pope was going to resign in March or April of 2012 because of all the other things that's supposed to happen, non-biblical sources, 2012. Well, it just came out, you know, just in the last few days or maybe a week or two, that the Pope actually did give a letter that he would resign last year in March or April, but it was not made public and only like 6 cardinals knew about it. But then he actually, you know, gave them like a 1-year notice or whatever that next year by March the 1st, I'll be out, I'll retire, which is what he did. So all of that stuff that these people did from all these different angles all came out to the same thing. All the Mayans, the Cherokee Indians, they also have a prophecy of the, you know, the feathered rattlesnake will return at this time. You know, even there's a Hindu book, the Vishnu, where it talks about the Shiva, which is the god of destruction, would come at this time. So all of these satanic sources and then the Malachi and all that are questionable sources. They could have possibly been from God or not. You know, they've been very accurate. It could have also been from the enemy. We don't know. They've all appear to be coming together all at the same time. Now, on top of all that, you know, this is all that other non-biblical stuff. And, you know, all those people, like I say, the Savior comments were non-biblical source. Because the biblical events are also happening, okay? There's been talk about peace, peace, peace in Israel. You know, like I said, there's tons of people who are making videos, and it has nothing to do with what the Bible says. The Bible says in Joel that they're going to divide the land. The Antichrist, okay, and Daniel and all that, we see that the land is going to be divided. The land of Israel will be divided. That's what this 7-year confirming of a covenant by someone who is a descendant of the people who destroyed the temple. That's the Roman Empire, okay? That, you know, that will be the Antichrist. It is going to be a 7-year treaty, and it's going to be about dividing the land. And part of that will be to let them rebuild a temple. This is all biblical, not what other, all this foolishness that people are talking about. Okay. So all of that things, the things they keep talking about, and all the people keep talking about, all the politicians, two-state solution, started by George Bush Sr. And the day he made his speech in the Madrid Peace Conference, his house in Kennebunkport, Maine, was hit by a giant freak wave during a freak storm that went backwards. Instead of going northeast, it went, whatever, southwest, a backwards running storm. And a giant wave went through the front of his house and messed it up. That's a whole other topic. Every time people mess with Israel, God messes with them, the United States. You know, President Bush Jr., he made Israeli, through Sharon, give up one of their settlements. And they had like, you know, 5,000 or 10,000 people displaced and homeless. That's when New Orleans, you know, the Hurricane Katrina came. We had 100,000, whatever it was, hundreds of thousands of people homeless and displaced out of New Orleans at the same time. It's just, there's tons of those. You can look up those, Google those. God, you know, anybody that messes with the Israelis, they're touching the apple of God's eye. Anyway. So all those things are happening right now. You know, when the Pope resigned, the lightning struck the Vatican. There's that plague of locusts in Egypt. You know, these are all the earthquakes going on. I mean, all of the biblical signs are happening. You know, President Obama is going there. He is an excellent candidate to be the one to make the peace deal. Why? Because he's the president of the most powerful nation on earth. Okay, he's in a position. Someone else could slide in there. I've said this in the videos before. Someone could slide in there. The king of Jordan is trying to get involved. And he is a king. The Antichrist is called the willful king. You know, he's a king. But it could be, you know, a president too. But it could be a literal royal bloodline king. You know, like the Hashemite king. That's the king of Jordan. The Lord had given me that name, but he didn't say what it meant. The Hashemite king. Okay, I know that he's a descendant of Muhammad. Or could it be one of these, you know, the king of Spain or France and all these different things. You know, Dr. Jack Menippe thought it was Juan Carlos of Spain for all these years. Lots of people thought it was Xavier Solanas. That's who I used to be my number one candidate before. He's so old and retired now in his 70s. Anyway, so the Malachi prophecy says that this next pope will be the pope during the tribulation, and then the Lord will return, and the dreadful judge will come and judge his people. Okay, and there's tons of Catholic scholars who believe the final pope will be the false prophet. And then there's Catholic scholars who do not believe he will be the false prophet. So it's a debate, okay, amongst them. But the Catholic Church is 1.2 billion people, and the pope has a huge power and sway in this world. You know, I guess it's the large, you know, Islam, I think, is 800 million or 900 million. The Vatican is 1.2 million. Okay, so it's a huge sway of power in the world. And he would be an excellent candidate to either be the Antichrist or the false prophet. Brothers and sisters, I just don't know what to say because, you know, this month, all these things are coming together. Look, and you know, I made a video about personal confirmations. I wanted to mention this, you know, Korea. The Lord had showed me before I started my channel, I had a dream that made me start my channel. And I had two dreams. And one of those, we were looking at a map of the world, and all these people were debating about the end times. And then suddenly we heard a loud explosion, and we looked, and it was like a big map, flat map, like in a war room. You know, everyone standing around looking at it. And we looked, and there was a nuclear explosion on the Korean Peninsula. You know, and it was just like everybody was quiet, and it was just like leading to, you know, just at the rapture or prior to the rapture. But anyway. All those, you know, those things are happening now. And I made a video with the Lord. He told me that it would be a virus outbreak. And then I saw today also on the RaptureReady.com, there's a new virus that's came from animals and it's killing people and it's a new thing. It's a new virus. And then it came from the Middle East and now there's people in England dying from it too. And I'm not sure if that's it. I mean, the Lord told me one of the road signs for his return that for me personally was a virus outbreak, a new, you know, a powerful virus. And this is a new one. And I believe that that's it. But I mean, I don't know. Because, you know, I can only say what the Lord told me. You know, and if he gives me specifics, I can say specifics. If he don't, I can't say it. But, you know, this month of March could pass and then nothing. You know, it could all be another cycle of, and just another birth pain. Every time we have one of these, you know, big contraction birth pains, it's like all the stuff's going on. Then it settles down a little bit. You know, and then it just keeps going on and on and on. You know, and just can't keep going on forever. There's going to be a time when suddenly the church is going to be out of here. Like the day of Pentecost, the church was born mysteriously with a mighty rushing wind, and the church is going to disappear, you know, in fire, mighty rushing wind, you know, and just like the church was born. And we'll leave as a mystery also. People call it, it says the harpozo, the catching away, the rapture in Latin. For those who come and say, the word rapture is not in the Bible. It's a Latin word for caught up from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, 18 in there. So there's so much going on, brothers and sisters, and all this speculation. This could be it. We should be in high rapture watch. You know, we should be vigilant and diligent. And that's what I was praying. I was like, Lord, you know, I don't want to get on here and make some speculative statement and then boom, you know, it's just nothing happens in March. It's just, you know, a dud. It just goes on and then nothing goes down. It's just, you know, it's just keep right on going. And all this settles down. I don't know. But it's, you know, everything is coming together. It's been coming together and more clearly coming together. It's just a matter of time. And, you know, I want the rapture to happen, but I've said this many times, brothers and sisters. When the rapture happens, and then we think about, and when we face the judgment seat of Christ, and we think about how we just, you know, kept running to and fro and trying to find out what day's the rapture and all this wacky speculation, and then we didn't win anybody to the Lord, We didn't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit so we could be used by the Lord in His power. We didn't operate in the gifts of the Spirit to show God's power to the lost, that somebody might have got saved, as I read from you the other day. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 through 3 or 4 there, it says that our faith should not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. And He said, I came to you not in excellency of words, but in a demonstration of the power of God. Talking about signs and wonders, people being healed, prophetic words, all that stuff, the gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And it's just a sad situation, brothers and sisters. I will say it again. I made a video about praying and praying for people and praise and worship, and 125 people watch it just yesterday. I can make a video about, you know, that the rapture, the Lord show me when's the rapture going to be, and 2,000 or 3,000 people will watch it. And, you know, it's just sad. It's sad. I mean, it's sad. People are going to have to give an account to the Lord for that. If you're still watching this video, and I'm going to give this one a good title, so I'm sure it'll get a lot of views by the grace of God. But I'll just say, it's sad. I pray that the spirit of conviction would get a hold of you right now. I want to pray right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, in the name of Jesus, let your spirit light a fire under the backside of everyone watching this video, Lord, that they would get up off of their blessed assurance, as John Hagee says, and get busy for the kingdom of the living God and making disciples of the nation and nations in the name of Jesus. Brothers and sisters, if there's any little detail of this video, a minor point of this video, please don't send me a comment about a minor point in this video that has nothing to do with the topic. Don't think about yourself. I've given this acronym before. It's joy. If you want joy, you have to put Jesus first, others second, and yourself last. But most people have it in reverse. They spell it Y-O-J. That's why they don't have joy. They put themselves, yourself first, and others second, and then Jesus last. And, yeah, let me just say that. If you see something in a video that's preaching, and you put it, I mean, it's all about Jesus. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. It's about the Lord. You know, people take things the wrong way. I made a video about, you know, of the orphanage. And then I showed a picture of the children going, you know, they went swimming and all this stuff. And they had a cookout. You know, it was the first birthday of the daughter of the house, mom and dad. And they had a birthday party. And then they went to the beach. And it's about 3 kilometers from the beach there at the house. And people were saying when they saw the video, they said, I'm reminded to enjoy my inner child. The purpose of the video was to show you the kingdom of God in action, and that these little orphans are being blessed by the sponsors and by us here serving them and parenting them and mentoring them and telling them about Jesus and praying for them and all that. The purpose was to show the kingdom of God in action, not about your inner child. I mean, stop looking at yourself and loving yourself so much and start loving Jesus and then loving your neighbor as yourself. But I see that people just love themselves so much and they don't really care too much about anybody else, particularly about the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm believing the rapture. I'm excited about the rapture, but in my heart of hearts, the rapture is going to be a sad day for this world. Woe unto this world. It's going to be a sad day for those who are left behind. And we Christians, hey, where's our compassion and our feelings for these people? And even more important than other people, as I said, is Jesus. The Lord is weeping for those people. The Lord is came to seek and save the lost. Our heart should be the Lord's heart. That let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. You know, the Bible says we have the mind of Christ. So His mind is on seeking and saving the lost. Stop thinking about yourself. We're in a high rapture watch. This is an opportunity for you to redeem the time. This is an opportunity for you to lay up. Here's something to think about yourself. Here's an opportunity for you to store up treasure for yourself in heaven. Here's an opportunity for you to be a blessing. Now I speak right now that God has already done it, and I speak it again. God will bless you that you can become a blessing like Father Abraham. He said, I bless you that you can be a blessing. So I speak in Jesus' name that the Lord would bless you that you can be a blessing right now in somebody's life. May the Lord use you to bring in that harvest. Let's win the lost. Let's do the will of the Lord.